Hello, this is Professor James Strickler, and this is a course in American government. This lesson is from Unit 9 about civil rights. It's Lesson 10 about affirmative action. This will be the last lesson in Unit 9. In this lesson, you'll learn about affirmative action, about the concept of a colorblind constitution, and about the United States Supreme Court case of Regents versus Bakke. Affirmative action is a concept that involves public policies, in other words, actions by the government, that favor otherwise or previously disadvantaged groups. Now, what we mean by that is groups that, without that favoritism by the government, would either be disadvantaged or that had been disadvantaged at some time in the past. Basically, the government's trying to help out groups that in some way they believe have been treated unfairly by society. An example of affirmative action would be members of racial minority groups applying for college and are receiving some sort of bonus points on their applications. Groups that support affirmative action believe that it's actually more fair than simply treating everybody equally. You can see in this illustration how they might think about this. The picture on the left, you have everyone being treated equally, being given the same size box to stand on to look over the fence. But some people are taller, some people are shorter. So what a person who supports affirmative action might do is redistribute the boxes so that everybody can look over the fence the same. In their mind, that's better than equality. That's really what we should be seeking after, some way to make society fair, even if along the way, different people get different benefits. Opponents of affirmative action believe that it's really just reverse discrimination. That we as a society say, hey, we don't discriminate anymore, but we're going to continue to discriminate, but in this case, to try to help out some groups rather than hurt them. But in the end, helping one group automatically hurts the other. For somebody who disagrees with affirmative action, they might say, the way to stop discriminating based on race is to just stop discriminating based on race. Whether affirmative action is a bad or a good idea, it raises questions about whether it's constitutionally allowable in the first place. Those questions become because of the Equal Protection Clause in the Constitution that says no state will deny anybody equal protection of the laws. Well, is a state treating people equally if through affirmative action it gives some sort of benefits to one group that it's not giving to another? Someone like Frederick Douglass would seem to disagree with that idea. Remember, Frederick Douglass was the man who was born into slavery, escaped to freedom in the North, turned out to be a powerful speaker and a powerful writer, who was one of the leaders of the movement to abolish slavery. In the aftermath of the Civil War, he was an important political figure. And here we see him saying that the Constitution knows no distinction among people because of their color. In other words, the Constitution should not be deciding anything based on race, whether it be to hurt one group or to help one group. And he goes on to say that if the Constitution is being seen that way, then clearly Congress shouldn't be able to pass laws that make such distinctions. This view of Frederick Douglass is echoed in the words of John Marshall Harlan, who dissented in the case of Plessy versus Ferguson. You may recall Plessy versus Ferguson was a case that we saw earlier in the course, where the Supreme Court declared that separate but equal, in other words, segregation, was constitutional. At that time, John Marshall Harlan said that the Constitution shouldn't permit any government authority to even know the race of people, much less somehow react to it to either keep them off of a train car or to give them a bonus on college admission or whatever it is. The view of these two men is what you could call the colorblind view of the Constitution, the idea that the Constitution simply prohibits any consideration of race, whether it be to try to harm a group or to try to help a group. The Constitution should just simply ignore what their race is. In addition to affirmative action perhaps having constitutional problems, it may also have legal problems when it's carried out by either the government or some sort of private business. Well, where would these potential legal problems come from? Well, let's remember what Dr. Martin Luther King taught. In his I Have a Dream speech, he talked about his ideal world in which his children would be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. In other words, as people decided whether or not his children were doing good or bad, they would not consider their skin color at all. Instead, they would simply consider their talents and their actions. Well, that point of view was enshrined in law in the Civil Rights Act of 1964. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 had a bunch of provisions in it that would seem to eliminate discrimination of one sort or another. Here's an example, where it says that it's unlawful to refuse to hire or to fire someone or otherwise discriminate against them because of their race. In other words, think about it. If you can't hire or fire someone because of their race, then that means not only can you not fire them because they're black, but you also can't hire them because they're black. This seems to be saying that you can't consider race either way, for negative or for positive. So this is a colorblind view of civil rights that we see in the words of Martin Luther King and in the language of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. But while seemingly the Constitution and the Civil Rights Act both take a view that race should not be considered in our society, we have to remember from the previous lesson, it doesn't mean that things like that are always absolute. Remember, we used the example of whether children can drive or not. When the government prohibits children from driving a car, what it is discriminating against them. But it's a kind of discrimination that we generally consider to be valid. So as we consider that, we recognize that the government is drawing lines where on one side of the line, discrimination is not allowed. On the other side of the line, it is allowed. And we said that it's really the United States Supreme Court that's deciding where those lines are. Then we referred to this chart that we made to help us to figure out how the court would judge one sort of discrimination or another. They would, first of all, determine whether or not the group being discriminated against was a suspect class or a non-suspect class. And then if it's a suspect class, they're going to require a compelling reason for that group to be treated differently. If it's a non-suspect class, they'll just require a rational basis. We then pointed out that race falls into the suspect class category, which means that for the government to treat people differently based on race, perhaps through affirmative action, they would have to have a compelling reason to do so. Now, please keep in mind that these various tests of creating suspect classes and requiring compelling interest and all that kind, none of that's actually in the Constitution. This is just stuff that the court has made up. So while the Constitution may be written in what seem like absolute terms, that no state will deny people equal protection of the law, period, the courts create exceptions to things all the time. And they just have to decide, do you have a good enough reason for the exception? So what they're going to require for situations where somebody's treated differently because of their race is a compelling interest. The Supreme Court had to face using this test to judge discrimination based on race in a case that may seem unusual, Regents of the University of California versus Backe. Now, the reason I say it's unusual is that if you were to imagine, without knowing about this case beforehand, what sort of case would the United States Supreme Court take to decide whether or not it was okay to discriminate based on race, you would probably imagine, that the person being discriminated against would be a member of some minority group. But in fact, it was a white man who brought the case complaining that he had been racially discriminated against. He was an applicant for medical school in California, And he had higher test scores than some other people who were admitted to the medical school who had been allowed in on a quota system where the school decided that they needed a certain number of people of each race. And so they would let in as many people as they needed. I should say they would let in people until they had fulfilled the number that they wanted of blacks or Hispanics or Asians or Native Americans or whatever it was. So anyway, they let these other people in to fulfill these quotas that they had established. And there were people who were allowed into the university who had lower scores than Backe, but he was rejected. I'm sorry, I said let in the university, let into the medical school, I mean. So Backe brought a lawsuit claiming he had been discriminated against. The state of California had not provided him with equal protection. When the United States Supreme Court considered this case, they had to decide whether or not this affirmative action program violated the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution and the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Now, if you take those two things at face value, it would seem that, well, yeah, it probably has violated them. But despite that, the United States Supreme Court ended up reaching a different decision. The first thing they did is that they recognized that racial and ethnic distinctions of any sort are inherently suspect. Now, what they mean by that is that the Equal Protection Clause can't just protect black people. If it's really requiring the government to treat everybody equally, then it's going to have to protect white people also. So they're saying, okay, Backe, yeah, you've got a case here that you're going to fall under the protection here. And then they say, but even though you fall under the protection of this passage in the Constitution, we believe that the state government trying to obtain a ethnically diverse student body at the medical school is a worthy constitutional goal. In other words, the pursuit of diversity, in their mind, is a compelling interest. All right, so that means the quotas are okay. No, actually it doesn't. The Supreme Court went on to say that, well, I'm sorry, having a fixed number of people in certain slots is not needed to achieve diversity. You can't do that. But it said you can have race as a plus factor when considering someone's application. So now let's put it all together and see what this case decided. First of all, it decided that yes, a white guy can sue under the Equal Protection Clause and demand equal protection also. And that when he does sue, just like if it were a black man, he can only be discriminated against if the government has a compelling reason to do so. They next decided that trying to create a diverse student body is a compelling reason. But then they thirdly decided that you have to go about it the right way. You can't just have a quota, a certain number of people of each race you're going to let into the school. Instead, everybody has to compete with everybody, but you can give people of the groups you're trying to get, trying to attract, trying to include in your school, you can give them an extra bonus on their application, a plus factor. You know, let's imagine applications are on a 10-point scale. You can say, well, everybody who's of group X that we're trying to get more of, we're going to give them an extra 10 points on their evaluation, whatever it may be. So in the end, they ended up saying, hey, California, you can do affirmative action, but you're doing it the wrong way. So Backe gets in because you screwed up and did it the wrong way with him. So in a sense, he won. He won the battle, but in another sense, he lost the war because they said affirmative action is still okay if it's done right. Well, decisions like this were problematic for some Supreme Court justices who looked at the Constitution or looked at the Civil Rights Act and said, you know, I know you're saying that that in your mind affirmative action is an okay idea, but if you just look at the words of the Civil Rights Act, it seems to be outlawed. If you just look at the words of the Equal Protection Clause, it seems to be unconstitutional. So judges who noticed that were then forced to make a choice. they could either choose to support the decision of the court, or they could say, no, 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 the court's wrong. This is what the Constitution, the Civil Rights Act say. Here's an example of how many judges chose to deal with that conflict. This is John Paul Stevens, a member of the United States Supreme Court. And he simply says, you know what, in 1978, in the Bakke case, we decided that the Civil Rights Act allows affirmative action type programs. So the colorblind language used by the senators and congressmen who created that law is no longer controlling. Now think about what he's saying there. The members of Congress created this law to prohibit things like affirmative action. But in the Bakke case and other cases like that, we actually decided it was okay to do it. And so you know what controls now? It's not what the Congress members of Congress originally intended to do. What controls now is what we decided to do. That's what the law means now, what we interpreted it to mean. This was later confirmed in another United States Supreme Court case, Grutter versus Bollinger, that came along decades later, where the Supreme Court explicitly said that the use of race in admissions, in this case to a law school instead of a medical school, can fulfill a compelling interest if you're trying to create a diverse student body. So this is what the United States Supreme Court accepts as a compelling reason to have affirmative action. In other words, programs that are designed to benefit members of disadvantaged groups in some way can be justified even when they're discriminating against other people if they are intended to create diversity in the student body or the workforce or whatever it may be. So despite the language in the Equal Protection Clause in the Civil Rights Act, the United States Supreme Court has said that affirmative action is acceptable. Now let's review what we learned in this lesson. What is an example of affirmative action? Is it outlying activities? Is it new government spending? Is it raising taxes? Or is it racial quotas for hiring? And an example of affirmative action would be having racial quotas for hiring. In other words, saying, we are going to hire 20% Latinos and 10% Chinese and 5% Pacific Islanders or whatever it is, whatever combination the particular place decided to do. That'd be an example of how affirmative action might be done. Now, as an aside, it's an example of a type of affirmative action that the Supreme Court in Bakke said is not allowable, but it would still be a way potentially to do affirmative action. And it's a particularly easy example to illustrate. What does it mean if the Constitution is colorblind? Does it mean that all races are citizens? Does it mean that the Constitution doesn't even mention race? Does it mean that government may consider race when it does stuff? Or does it mean that the government cannot consider race when it does things? A colorblind constitution would mean that the government cannot even consider race. So that would mean, for example, that affirmative action would not be allowed. So what did the Bakke case rule then? Did it rule that affirmative action is illegal? Did it rule that affirmative action is legal? Did it rule that rational basis is for racism? Or did it rule that race is a quasi-suspect class? The Bakke case ruled that affirmative action is legal and constitutional. Okay, that completes this lesson, and it completes Unit 9. The next lesson will be from Unit 10, Lesson 1, about the mass media.